Picture Miss Seeton by Heron Carvic and read by Phyllida Nash. Picture Miss Seeton by Heron Carvic and read by Phyllida Nash. Chapter 1. L'amour est tum, tum de something. So colourful. Not romantic. No, one couldn't call it that. If anything, perhaps a trifle sordid. Carmen herself, for instance, no better than she should be. In fact, if one were frank, worse. And the other girl, the young one, it was difficult to feel sorry for her. Her fiancé, quite obsessed with his mother, obviously weak and easily influenced, would have made a most unsatisfactory husband in any case. Still, for him to stab Carmen at the end like that, so unnecessary, almost contrived. Though, of course, one must not forget that foreigners felt differently about these matters. One read that people abroad did frequently get emotional and kill each other. Probably the heat. Miss Seeton stepped aside to avoid a pile of crates. She peered at them. Civil oranges. How interesting. Spain. Such an odd coincidence. One might almost think that one was back in one's seat at the theatre with the warm glow of the lights. Qui n'a jamais, jamais, tum, tum, something. Cracked, yes. Off key, yes. But a warm glow had started up inside Miss Seeton. Her visit to the opera tonight was really in the nature of a celebration. Tomorrow morning she would set out on an adventure. No, no, that was putting it too strongly. Set out upon a new way of life, or at least the beginning of a new way, which would be, of course, in its way, an adventure for her. Where was she now? If she turned right here. Gracious, how dark this alleyway looked. Should people park their cars all down one side, with their wheels on the pavement too? It should take her towards Tottenham Court Road. Or she might even catch her bus in Charing Cross Road. This walk had been a good idea. She felt quite a spring in her step. Was it her rubber soles? Or could it be just possibly, that they were doing her good? Miss Seeton drew in her breath and braced herself. Of course it was ridiculous taking up exercises at her age. But that advertisement had looked so encouraging. Even when the book arrived and one realised the difficulties, it had still appeared to be worth trying. There was no question the tiresome stiffness in her knees did seem to be better. A lot of the positions were, well, embarrassing, even to oneself. But, after all, if no one knew, and if it helped... Oh! Miss Seeton prepared to hurry by a couple pressed into an adjacent doorway when the girl spat, Merde-toi, putain, saligo, scélérat, si tu me merdes. She ended on a gasp as the boy's arm drove into her side. Oh, no, really. Miss Seeton stopped. Even supposing the girl had been rude, and it had certainly sounded so, there was no excuse. A gentleman did not hit. She prodded him in the back with her umbrella. Young man! He whirled and leapt. Deflected by the umbrella, he landed beside the prostrate Miss Seeton. Grabbing her by the coat, he jerked her towards him. A blaze of light froze him as the headlights of a car farther down the alley were switched on and an engine started. There was a scuffle of movement and her coat released. Miss Seeton fell back on her elbows as the boy jumped to his feet and ran. With the help of her umbrella, she pushed herself upright. Really? The foreign temperament. So impulsive. A car door slammed. A man's voice called, Stay where you are, Mabel. The thwack of running footsteps. Are you all right, madam? What happened? Miss Seeton looked around. A heavy, middle-aged man appeared from behind the beam of light, hurried towards her and grasped her arm. The man who attacked you, did he hurt you? Miss Seeton, a little breathless, considered. No, I don't think so. It was just the surprise. But you were on the ground. the man insisted. He had hold of you. It was all so unexpected. I startled him, you see, and it made him jump. We both fell down. Then he pulled me. I think he was trying to help me up.
Then why did he run?
She appeared puzzled. Well, there was the girl. Such bad manners. But then, of course, he's not English.
The girl? What girl?
They were in that doorway there. She cried out something that sounded rude and he hit her. I'm afraid I interfered. I do think, don't you, she continued earnestly, that the young must learn to behave. Surely, even abroad. The man glanced at the empty doorway, took a step and, leaning on the bonnet of one of the parked cars, saw the huddled body of a girl wedged between the wing of the car and the wall.
Good God, you're right. He knocked her out. Just a minute. I'll prop her up against the door.
Miss Seeton moved to help. Perhaps she's fainted, poor thing. Oh! She gave a shocked cry. As the man shifted the body, the girl's coat fell back and the glare of the headlamp shone on the handle of the knife in her side. No, wait. Don't move her yet. We must get a doctor. She, look! She's been stabbed. Stabbed, but of course stabbed. That was inevitable somehow. This dazzlement of light, spotlights. The slope of the alley steepened. To keep her balance, Miss Seeton leaned against the car. Spotlights. Oranges? Civil? That was it. It had happened before. She'd seen it. Watched it happen before. Someone was speaking to her urgently.
It's too late for a doctor. This girl is dead. We must get the police.
The man gazed almost in awe at the little figure, hat askew, coat awry, gloved hands still clasping her umbrella.
You mean you actually saw this happen? What made him do it?
Miss Seeton straightened. He has to, she explained. It's the last act. She shook her head. Suddenly she felt very tired. But it's so silly, really. And it's quite unnecessary.
Would you like another cup of tea, miss?
The constable at Bow Street Police Station made the suggestion as a conversational gambit to break an awkward silence. Miss Seeton contemplated the emulsive remains of what appeared to be sweetened tar at the bottom of her cup. How kind. Although the room was warm, it was true she felt a little cold. If I might have it very weak, nearly all water and with no sugar, I should be most grateful.
Sure you won't have something to eat while you're waiting?
No, really. I had a meal before the theatre. But, she hesitated, I wonder if you'd be kind enough to ask about my handbag. I'm a little worried, you see. It's getting late and I have no money on me. Also, there's my latchkey. The constable turned at the door.
Don't you worry about that, miss. We'll see you get home all right. And as for your bag, the boys have got a description. If it's there, they'll find it and let you know at once. Anyway, it won't be long now. The yard should be here any minute. I'll go and rustle up your tea.
He closed the door behind him with a sigh of relief.
Funny old trout. You'd think she'd be all of a twit, but she was as calm as you please. Probably came of teaching kids. Once he'd coped with kids these days, he'd cop the lot.
Miss Seeton looked up as the door opened. A grey day on Heathland came in briskly, followed by a footballer. No, really, this was too fanciful. She must be tired. Next she would be seeing people as shapes with holes in them. A perfectly ordinary, tall, rugged, middle-aged man in tweeds, followed by a perfectly ordinary, though very large, scrubbed young man in a dark suit. It made no difference. She was still left with the impression of a grey sky and heather ruffled in the wind. And the young man's suit was entirely wasted. He might just as well have been wearing, in fact, more appropriately, several yards of striped wool muffler, shorts and those stockings one associated with Alice in Wonderland, except, of course, that footballers' stockings were shorter and thicker. The grey day, the older man smiled and spoke. Miss Seeton, no...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.